Can you please give me your name, age, and hometown?
My name is Tony Schatz. I live here in Madison, South Dakota. What else?
Age, please.
My age is 84. This month I'll be 85.
Can you please give me your branch of service, rank, and the unit you served with?
I was in U.S. Navy. I was a boatswain mate first class aboard the USS Block Island 21 and also Block Island 20 106.
How aware were you of what was happening overseas before Pearl Harbor?
I was working in Spokane, Washington, in a warehouse.
Were you aware of what was happening in Europe and in...
Well, we didn't know about it till they hit Pearl Harbor.
How was it from training into the
Well, I
Navy?
was just working in a warehouse, and then the war broke out. And after several months, I got my notices 1A. So I went down, and I didn't want to go in the Army. So I inquired at all the other interviews, and I ended up over in the Navy. And I was more or less inquiring, but they gave me a physical, and next thing I know, they told me to report in the morning. And I says, no, I gotta wait. I gotta have at least 2 weeks, a week to sell my car and get things organized. Well, then they turned around and gave me a week, and next thing I knew, I was on my way to Bremerton, Washington, from Spokane. This all took place in Spokane. I was on my way to Bremerton, Washington. Bremerton, Washington, they sent me to my train to San Diego, and there I boarded a ship, the USS Block Island 21. We went around through the Panama Canal. I ended up in Norfolk, Virginia. There we took a couple of trips to Belfast, Ireland, transporting planes. Then we come back, and then we had orders to leave for North Africa. And we got out there. Well, we found out our job was to go look for German subs, submarines that were sinking our convoys and so forth. And we had three escorts ships with us, destroyers, small ones, and we'd be out probably a month looking for them. And when we would sink one, we sunk about five or six of them. But I would say after about two or three, why, we took some survivors off of them, and then we would take them into North Africa and dump them off and go back out and look again. Well, the last bunch we took in with all the souvenirs I got, I sent home. And the next trip out, I guess it was their turn, they got us. So about 8:15 at night, we took a, they destroyed one of our escorts, hit the front bow, destroyed it. We took three torpedoes on the one side. And the next thing we were on general quarters then. The next thing orders we got was to abandon ship. So I was very concerned because I was on watch. I had captain of a quad 40 millimeter gun, and we took turns. I had to send men up about 50 feet to go for a lookout. And one of my men up there, his name was Franks, when the torpedo hit below, it come up and it pinned him right through the legs and stuff. So when we got orders to abandon ship, I went over there and tried to do everything I could, but then medics come over there and told us to leave. Well, I knew what it was. The guy wasn't going to make it. So I and a little Mexican boy, a friend of mine, and another fellow, the three of us, we jumped over the side and started swimming. The hard part was we were on an aircraft carrier and we were just out, so we had high octane gasoline and oil. Our big problem was swimming through the oil and gas. We were swallowing some of that. We had what we called donuts out there that you could hang on the side. They're about 6 foot by 4 foot, and they had a net in the middle. And I spotted, or between the three of us, we spotted one out there maybe a half mile or three quarters. I can't quite remember. After a couple of hours or so forth, we made it out there to found this donut, and there was about four or five other men on it. So, but you couldn't sit on it because it would sink, you know. So we hung on it all night long. Towards early next morning, we did spot a group of men about, oh, maybe a half mile away. So we decided we should work our way over there because the bigger the group, the more they could find you. But I don't know, I'm just guessing. It's been 60 years ago. It must have been about 10 o'clock in the morning or close to noon the next day. Next thing I know here, there was a ship right alongside of me, one of our destroyers. So the men, we tried to climb up the ladder. It was a rope ladder, but you know, it was covered with oil, or the guys had gone up before that. but they had what they call on the side of the ship a buoy, looked like about the size of a garbage can, made out of rope and knots and so forth. Well, I got my hands in one of those, and I wasn't about to let go. And I climbed up there, and then I was helped aboard the ship. We stayed out there a couple of more days looking for survivors, and then they took us into North Africa, Casablanca. They took us into an army big building. It looked like a warehouse, had cots in it. They issued us army khakis and so forth, and army shoes and so forth. We were in there, about 3 weeks. And then another small aircraft carrier came into Casablanca. We were put aboard that, and we were sent home and on a 30-day survivor's leave. Anytime a ship is sunk, you always got a 30-day survivor's leave. That was one of the happiest days of my life. I came home, and I married the girl I left behind. While I was home, I got orders to report to Bremerton, Washington. At Bremerton, Washington, they were just commissioning a new ship, and they renamed it USS Block Island 106. They held the ship up for two, 3 weeks, if I remember, because they were holding up the invasion of Belknap, Borneo. Because of our ship, they figured we had an experienced crew. It was not our sailors, but our flight deck up above, our Marines, our pilots, and so forth. So we left, and we went into the invasion of that. Everything turned out all right. We left that, and then I was in all the islands, Leyte, Guam, Manila, and also Okinawa. We went into Okinawa 2 or 3 times. And while we were in Okinawa, that's when we were getting ready to invade Japan. And of course, we were all out there, and them crazy suicide planes were coming in on us. But we were fortunate. We were never took a hit. But a USS Franklin, some of the men that were on our ship that got sunk were on that ship, and we lost some of those men. I went aboard that ship. And if you ever seen a car that was on fire, that had burnt, that's what that ship looked like. How anybody got out of there alive, I don't know. But the ship could still be under power, and they went into Honolulu. That's the last I seen. But when the bomb was dropped, we were just getting ready to go into Japan. About 2 days after they dropped the bomb, we got orders to go into this island where there were supposed to have been some prisoners held. We didn't know if they were Americans or what they were. Well, we went in there. We found out that they were Australians and British. And there was about 75 or 80 of them. And we carried them out, and we put them on our ship and on the flight deck. I have pictures of this. We took them into Manila and dropped them off there. These guys are all skin and bones. As you can see, I've got, when I came home from the Navy, after I got home, the government, or I don't know where it come from, they sent me a book from the day my ship was commissioned, the 21 that was sunk, even up till the last ones. And all the pictures are in there of the ship sinking. I also have the pictures of the prisoners that we carried out on the deck, the whole thing, which makes it very interesting. Now, getting back, I don't know if I mentioned this before, when we had these German prisoners that, I don't know if I mentioned this, that they gave me the souvenirs, made up souvenirs for me. But anyway, after we dropped the prisoners off that the Japanese had captured in Manila, a point system came out that you could come home, providing you had so many points. And the reason they rated that is how long you've been in the service, how many battles you've been in, and the hardships you had and so forth. Of course, I had points to sell. But anyway, I got off the ship in Manila, got on an old freighter, I think it was, and only go about 8 knots, and it had a bent propeller. But I didn't care how long it was going to take to get back to the States, because I was going home. And we arrived at Honolulu, and we got some sandwiches, because we were scared to eat on the ship, because cocaine had broken out. And we had a few sandwiches. And from there, we went to San Francisco. From San Francisco, I was transferred back to Bremerton and discharged and was ready to go home. And at that time, they called me in and they offered me another promotion. And I says, no, you can make me admiral of this ship. I'm going home.
How should Americans remember World War II?
Well, the main thing is we just have to be prepared all the time, which really when World War II broke out, we weren't really prepared, you know. They'd sunk all our ships. We had all our ships over in Pearl Harbor, but it was amazing how fast a country could get together and repair these ships and all the ammunition and make planes and so forth and so on. It's amazing how this country can do this. I keep thinking now of the poor soldiers that are over in Iraq. When I watch them and I see all that big heavy gear and I think, my gosh, they've got to have bulletproof vests underneath, and here it is 100 and 110 degrees. Them poor guys, I don't know what they're going through. I don't know how they can stand up to that. And that's what makes me think about war now, you know. I often did say people in the United States here do not know what war is. When I was in Manila waiting for transportation to come back to the States, there was about 5,000 of us in there. They had facilities to for about 1,000 men. And to eat, you had to just start standing in line day and night. And we had little children, 5-6-year-olds with gallon cans out there, waiting when we come through with our tray, if we had any food left over, to throw it in this garbage. They wanted our garbage. So I would fill my tray, just heap it up, because I knew some little kid was out there wanting something to eat. And I often said, people in the United States here do not know what war is until they've gone through something like that.
Well, Tony, I want to thank you very much for your story that you shared with us today, and thank you very much for your service.